Dear colleagues, let's start. Maybe some more people will join us later, but I have lots of great colleagues here. And today we'll be doing the second more theoretical talk by Tim Schmalz, professor of the University College of London, the head of the Contemporary Psychology Lab from Sister Center in Trieste. Team, let's start.
Thank you. Well, 2 days ago I gave you a set of empirical phenomena related to lateralization of reproductive functions. But they were almost a set of separate empirical phenomena. I argued that if one has lesions of the left prefrontal cortex, then that's one more difficult. And more difficulty in setting the criteria for accuracy, for instance, for creating abstract representation, for working in that small problem spaces where you have a task that requires you to make a series of operations to get to a goal. Yeah. I argue that these are all left prefrontal primarily. Then I argue that there were two other situations which were more of processes more of the right hemisphere. One was the active monitoring of the actions that carried out and whether they were appropriate for the situation. And secondly, a shift to what I call distance schemas, but Goldilson calls lateral transformations, where you have to move from one conceptual domain to another to satisfy the task. And what I aim to do today is to, my talk will be divided into two halves. The first half, I'll try and draw some general principles about how one might theoretically link these two together, these five different processes together, or into two sets of three and two. But secondly, then the general principles won't relate to the discussion of prefrontal cortex at all, but to other sorts of disorders. And then I'll come back and apply the principles that come from the first part of the lecture to prefrontal processes in the second, and I'll introduce two other types of processes as well, prefrontal. So, if one's going to try and link processes together into some sort of common, with some common principle, it requires a sort of model in which to be doing that. In neuropsychology, there have been two main types of theoretical models which have been developed and used. Initially, from about the late 1960s onwards, the standard approach to explaining the psychological data was to assume there was a whole series of separate subsystems in the mind brain, and that individual ones could be damaged. So this typical model of the late 1980s of the word processing system, as far as input and output processes are concerned, with where you can have either a word spoken to the subject or subject reading the word, producing the word either by speech or by writing. This is a classic information processing model in which what happens then in particular, take one particular component, the graphemic output. late 1980s, Caramazzo and Riccelli described patients who had, they argue, specific problems of this, in this component of the model. So that these patients showed particular characteristics. When they tried to write a word that was dictated to them, then they tended to make errors of typically a single letter, or not possibly two letters. But a single letter error could be, for instance, the deletion of a letter. So they say Doyle, for instance. Or it could be an additional letter. Or they could actually transpose two letters, as in the example of you, those are the readers as encoded with the I and the O in the respective alternative positions. And if you looked at where these errors occurred in the words, they occurred typically in the, it was a serial position effect across the word, so the most likely to occur in the middle or in the late middle of the word, rather than anywhere else in the word. This again is quite not untypical of a memory phenomenon. So it was argued that what was happening is that when the word had been selected as an orthographic lexicon letter, the information in this buffer was being held in the buffer. Prior to it being actually realised in strokes on the page. Obviously, when you start rewriting the word, it's a process that takes a second or two crossing the word. There needs to be some sort of buffer to hold it, that this was the problem in these patients. And this sort of model seems to be doing extremely well at accounting for neuropsychological data till about 1990. And in the late 1980s, a new theoretical paradigm arose. But basically, initially from people in Cambridge, where Jeff Hinton, who later became the grandfather of deep learning, which is the underlying principle upon which most of the massive transformations in practical AI use, for instance, with Google and Facebook, utilize. He's the person that's done more than anyone else in the world to develop these new learning principles, deep learning principles. However, at the time he was working with some relatively simple neural nets in Cambridge, and a number of us collaborated. He stimulated the idea that neural net was a better way of trying to conceptualize the underlying processes rather than individual boxes as in the information processing models beforehand. And if you take one area of reading as an example, and I'll be very briefly the account of work that I did with him, and then when he got bored because it was too empirically related, and later collaborating with one of his research students in the cloud. So in the early models of reading, what was shown by Marshall and Newman was that there were complementary disorders affecting whether you read directly to the meaning of the word, which I think. Well, I'll just use that by root A, or you can read to a word by going from the visual form, or the orthographic form of the word, to the phonological form, independently of this phonetic system, and then use your auditory input system in order to comprehend the word. What Marshall Newman showed was there are two sorts of acquired dyslexia. One lost completely root A and read by means of graphic phone correspondences. Or the other sort lost entirely read and read directly from meaning but not otherwise. And this thing, a very convincing account. But there are other aspects of the disorder which weren't covered in that simple account. Instead, if you take deep dyslexia, which was first described by them in the mid-60s, by the mid-90s, about 20 or 30 or so patients of this sort have been described. They made cemented. You could see that there was good evidence that they were not using the phonological rules, they made errors which were semantically related when they wrote words. for instance, reading the work Cold as Ice. In addition, virtually all the nations also named Israelites, so they've been the word like gold as gold. They read concrete nouns very well, so this read, for instance, a word like tractor very easily, so abstract words or words with a purely grammatical function like or, were very poorly read, maybe less than 10%. So you've got this mixture of errors at times, and in addition, you had certain sorts of words being read very much more easily than other sorts of words. Sorry. What we showed, this is the work with Tim Platt and Jeff Hinton, is that we have a very simple network which you map from an orthographic level, so-called 28 graphemic units on the slide up to a semantic level, then and use a set of hidden units in the most traditional connections fashion post-1980. Then you damage anywhere where the 2 hours are shown, then you've got a pattern of disorders in the appropriate assumptions that are showing the syndrome. The one slight complication of the model is we have attached the model operates in certain time steps. So the first time step, the information is moving from the graphemic units to the intermediate units. Then the second time step into the semantic units. Then there are these feeder units coming. What they're designed for is to build what's called stronger tractors, so that the output of the network isn't just any old point in semantic space, but is clustered around one or other of the alternatives that the network knows exists. And you can see conceptually what's happening is if you consider what's the representation of semantics at different moments in time. Initially, you take a word like cot, it goes into a position in semantic space which is very close to the word cat, but then because of these so-called attractivations and the kingdom system, over seven time steps, it moves to a place in semantic space much closer to semantically related words, such as back. So these arrows are representing the processes going on over iterations, seven iterations of the model, such that the basis enable words to be semantically clustered. And you relate as an arrow to be close to one of the existing government words as opposed to others. So essentially, this digital network is virtually the simplest type of connections network that can transform an input into an output. Or take the semantic system itself. In 1975, Elizabeth Warrington in London described three patients with a demented condition who had lost knowledge of the meanings of words, but other capacities remained intact. So these patients knew very well where they were. They could do intelligence tests or visuospatial tasks completely normally. The first patient described was a very senior member of the Foreign Office engaged in negotiations over Britain joining the EU, who could write a text about what he was doing in the negotiations at a very abstract level, without mentioning any concrete things. But if you didn't know what a pig was, for instance, either as when sure a pig visually or hearing the word pig. And many such patients have since been described, well known now that they have lesions in the bilateral lesions in the anterior temporal cortex. And they're very affected by word frequency, how the depth of processing right? They know, for instance, the rhinoceros has got a, is an animal, but they don't know that it has a particular sort of double horn. And they're highly consistent with 1 test, session 29. Group in Cambridge and Wisconsin modeled this disorder in terms of the idea that there was a central hub for which collected all the information about the somatic skeleton. And this was linked to spokes which held information about a particular type of information. So the sound that something would produce, for instance, a dog barking, would be partially held in a particularly auditory type of spoke, while the sight, the visual form of the dog would be held in the visual spoke. But the key aspect was the assumption that there was a central hub which was responsible for holding, basically integrating all the information across the different modalities. And in their simulation, Roger sets out two of the spokes, what they call the verbal descriptors and the visual descriptors. And then the model system by presenting a verbal description to the input, training to produce the appropriate visual features in the set of hidden units in the sentence. And at the same time, then they would then present visual features and train that to use the verbal output, verbal descriptors. So they trained in both directions across the input-output. And what that model then did was they looked to see how well they could explain the disorders of the patients, what the sort of errors that the patients made and how correct they are on a particular task. And what they found was that the different sorts of errors, this is showing on the different coloured lines, different types of errors, and you can see an extremely good match between the empirical data which is shown on the left and the model, I think, was subject to different degrees of damage on the right. So, in the second case, a very simple type of connections model with just input, output, and set of news in between. Can carry out, can implement apparently very well disorders in a particular domain. In fact, I will discuss it in the lecture, but I can discuss it afterwards. This is not an adequate model of semantics, but it certainly at that time it appeared. Even for concrete work semantics, it's not an adequate model. There are other disorders which it doesn't explain. Seems to suggest that one can have relatively simple which can be damaged and give rise to behaviors that fit well with the patient. So I call these basic connections networks. And computationally, these sort of networks fit very nicely with developments in functional imaging. In the current obsession with seeing everything in terms of networks rather than subsystems, which originated in about 2010, particularly from just having people in rest situations and then analysing by factor analytic procedures, the resulting information. So as they get a set of networks which appear to explain all aspects of cognition without having to bother with detailed information about individual subsystems proposed in the network, which you needed to do in the more traditional ones. These sorts of networks the internal parts of the body better explain its properties of the whole natural world, rather than its having idiosyncratic properties of the own. The internal units of work are what I would call network strongly permeable. Is this a sufficient account? This is a similar position, similar to that advocated by Patterson and Clout in the paper in 2009. I'm just going to the slide. I'm going to argue that that is an insufficient account of most disorders that cannot be explained by simple models of this sort. And I'll give an example of the Ruffini buffer disorder that I just described at the beginning. This can be seen as an example of the famous problem that was posed by Lashley in 1952, a serial order problem which arises in, for instance, speech output, writing output, music output, or short-term memory and the like. But typically what is critical is to get items that are from a fairly limited set in the appropriate order rather than just a single item output. About 1990, a man called George Walton put forward a type of model called competitive queuing. His model, in some respect, uses this control. His model, in some respects, are rather inelegant, because each worker that is known to the system has to have a separate network. So the idea is, for instance, taking this writing example, if you have a network which is dealing with the word house, then in order to get the letters in the appropriate order, what has to be done is you associate each letter with two nodes, an input node, label I, and an output node, label E, keep N. And the letters at the beginning of the word are more strongly associated with the input node, letters at the output, at the end of the word are more strongly associated with the end node. So that, and then over time, what happens when the word is being produced, the I node is initially strong and the E node is initially weak, and over time their relative strength changes according to the graph on the right. And this was a complete speculation by George 30 years ago. But just this last year, Cornichet and Neil Burgess et al. Were looking at motor sequence learning with a small, where the subjects were having to learn to make the appropriate finger movements in sequence. What they showed was that using mega activations of averaging over the whole cortex, if you look at the production of the sequence of movements, finger movements, then you find that before, where it says CQ joint operation, that's before the finger movements are started, you see there's an activation difference between the appropriate representations of each of the fingers, such as the first finger that is going to be moved is most strongly activated, the second finger next most strongly, third finger next most strongly, and so on. So that you have something that corresponds almost exactly to the activation of the I node in competitive queuing approach. It didn't seem in their data to be anything corresponding to the E note, but there was a strong approach to the I note. So these speculations that George Orwell had, at least partially, seem to be plausibly partially neurologically based. Go back to the competitive queuing model, having shown that it things has some new possibility. The model doesn't just contain as input nodes and emission nodes and end nodes. It also contains what's called a capacitive filter. Whichever of the item letter nodes are not activated at a particular time is inhibited, all the other are inhibited in the capacitive filter, and just that most strongly active letter node is output. Then that letter node is inhibited so as to allow for the next letter to be different. However, what happens if you get to a word like pretty, which where the same item node, letter node has to be activated twice in a row? If you strongly inhibit the T in pretty, first T in pretty, you won't be able to have enough activation to get the second T in pretty produced. And therefore, Orton suggested that there had to be what's called a gender node, namely a doubling node, which in a way acts like another letter, so that the had not only letter nodes, but also at the same sort of level, at the doubling operation node, so called gender node. And if you look at the patients that I just described, this is shows the serial position I showed before. They fit nicely, reasonably nicely from the point of view of the model. As you damage the model with adding noise of the competitive peering filter, for instance, then patients, which are shown in colour, fit reasonably well. The model, which is shown in grey, fits reasonably well with patient data as the effect of the word length is considered. If you look at the errors produced by the patient, whether they transpose letters or add a letter or subtract a letter. Again, this shows the model in grey with four different patients in different colours. The model fits reasonably well there. But finally, in addition, which I haven't got another slide of this problem, if you look at characteristic five of the patients, they also make errors in which this generate characteristic, this doubling process, moves to another letter. So, for instance, the word freeze is written as F-R-E-double-Z-E instead of R-F-R-double-E-Z-E. So many of the, this, in a sense, the generative facility or additional generative process is there required by the model because of inherent weakness of the model in certain situations. And patients show it is a very plausible assumption. It's possible to make connections versions of this where all the words are being held in the same network instead of separate networks. I won't go into the details of this, except to say that it gives rise to damaging different parts of the network, gives rise to different top sorts of patients. It do in fact exist. It shows a serial position in two different types of patient. And the critical thing about models of this sort, from the point of view of the overall argument that I'm presenting, is that these are not simple input, output, and hidden union types of models. They have lots of internal structure which is specific to that specific model. So this model, for instance, has this time. As the timing characteristic shown in green, and has this particular type of immediate inhibition of the late previous output shown also in green at the bottom. There are many characteristics, three characteristics of this model, which are additional, what I call additional tweaks to a standard relations principle. Now, I'm now going to move back the frontal cortex, having made the argument that for many subsystems, more complex internal structures required in the model is available in a simple connections network. And I'm going to ask, as far as prefrontal subsystems are concerned, what could be the additional tweaks that are needed in order to account for these five different sorts of disorder that I've discussed before. I'll begin. I made a rather bad choice. I thought I had given an additional example of a disorder, which is dynamic aphasia, only to discover that someone did it. It was far more about dynamic aphasia, and no doubt will say so in the discussion about it. In dynamic aphasia, which is another disorder which was first really put on the map by Loria in the late 1960s, like been described by another form by Kleist 50 years before. Spontaneous speech of the patient is very sparse. But when you can elicit some speech from the patient, the speech will be quite normal, chronologically, morphologically, syntactically. Now, if you take this, as far as I am, as a non-psychologist is concerned, the standard model of language outputs is produced by the Belt in the late 1980s. The Belt argues that production of speech involves three main stages. Of course, the conceptualized, which produces the preverbal message. Then that goes into the formulator, which encodes the information syntactically and phonologically. Then it's transmitted to the articulators, which control the movement of the muscles of the larynx and the like. And given that if it's accepted that these patients are normal, can be normal syntactically, normal phonologically, then the deficit must lie above the level of the preverbal message in what Bell calls the conceptualizer. Here are two of our patients in London. This, what they have to do here, that they're reasonably normal in other cognitive realms. They perform normally like IQ tests, for instance, and all that. When they have to describe a complex picture, you can see that their speech, the words that they produce per minute, is in one case about less than a sixth of the normal rate, about a sixth of the normal rate, in the other case, less than a tenth of the normal rate. And yet, if you look at syntactic markers, for instance, the proportion of verbs, in one case we get well within the normal range, in the other, only just below it, clearly much better than their performance in actually speaking. And yet, if you give them the right test, they can produce normal speech output. So this is where you have a simple, not a complex scene that I have to describe, but a simple scene, then the patient will go perfect in saying things like boy and girl riding an elephant. And if you take, there's a very famous aphasia test called the Token test, developed by two Italians at the American Milano in the 60s, called the Token test, where the patient, the experimenter gives, or clinician gives an instruction to the patient, for instance, move the squares away from the triangles, or something of that sort. In the reporter's test, it's the other way around. The clinician makes a certain set of movements with these objects, which are coloured triangles, squares, and circles. And then the patient has to say what the experimenter has done. So an example would be, you have selected four squares and four circles, you have tapped the circles harder than the squares. Again, these patients are perfect at that. However, if you go to the task of being any sentence including a specific word, if the word is a proper noun like Gander, for instance, and the patient is pretty good at saying Gander was an Italian politician who was murdered or something of that sort. On the other hand, if they have to do the same task but with a much more frequent word, like table, then they hope for performing unless they're 50% correct. And what was argued by Cicolotti and Rob Gomez, Gomez and Cicolotti, at much the same time by Thompson Shill, was that as you increase the number of possibilities that the brain goes to the patient, so the performance deteriorates. And both of these patients had lesions in the inferior frontal gyrus on the left, regions 44 or 45, you can see on the slide to the right. And these regions 44 or 45, together with 47, form the inferior frontal gyrus. And in the latest study, we looked at a number of patients who didn't have gross dynamic aphasia as far as the inferior frontal gyrus was concerned. We compared patients who had the inferior frontal gyrus on the left with other frontal patients without lesions in that region with normal controls. And we had to give the task of producing a sentence with a specific word in it. If the word was a proper noun, then the 15 sentences, all three groups would be nearly perfect. If it was a low frequency noun, like tractor, then there wasn't much difference between the three groups. If you've got a high frequency noun, like table, then the left inferior frontal group was significantly worse than the other two groups. And significantly. But this wasn't as dramatic an effect as with the individual dynamic aphasia patients. We were getting the same pattern as patients in region in the SFO region. If you look at the right frontal patients, there's no such effect. They're shown red, they're shown green on this slide. So as far as high frequency words, right frontal patients have no problem. So as far as the dynamic aphasia is concerned, it appears to be at the preverbal level on the Bell's framework. Low frequency words or proper names have small numbers of associations, so much more limited competition associations than for high frequency words. The effect seems to be related to what's called the fan effect or the peer overload effect in memory. And possible causes of 2-week lateral inhibition treatment in left inferior frontal gyrus or dynamic aphasia patients. So that if there are a lot of alternatives, they can't be adequately inhibited. Let's go to a different syndrome, but one from much the same region of the brain, the blockers aphasia, the classical neuropsychological syndrome. It includes, as shown by the animal, difficulties with comprehension of syntactically complex sentences and, of course, production of syntactically complex sentences. And one knows from anatomical studies like Tyler's in the early 10 years ago that the critical region of opinion gravitism is the left inferior frontal gyrus, which dropped the plane more than a century ago. Also been supported by more recent evidence. Blocker's claim is much disputed for many years. If one takes, this is a computational model, linguistic model, the Boston, two Dutchmen and Boston Kempers. If one considers the sub-processes required in comprehension of syntactically complex sentences, take the sentence, the woman sees the man with the telescope. What Boston Kempen argued is the least good process that differentiates whether there are links formed between the proposition of phrase, which with the telescope, whether that's linked to either the subject of the sentence, the woman, because it's the woman's telescope, or the object of the sentence, the man, which is the man's telescope, or it's the process by which the woman sees the man. comprehension of the sentence must involve a decision between these three alternatives. This standard idea of universal communication. There's another Dutch psychologist, Haggard, has argued that communication processes are properties specifically the left inferior frontal gyrus, is the same movement as we discussed. And a possible tweak to the computational system could be that unification could be implemented by what are called strong short-term weights in connections models in addition to the long-term weights that can be strengthened, for instance, by reinforcement procedures. You can also have short-term weights which carry information at short intervals of time but can keep them very strong. A possible tweak would be to have increased short-term weights carrying unification processes in that region. Another linguist that we get, and I should say I'm not a linguist, so I take these claims on with a certain amount of skepticism. Jaffenbach has argued that the pre-verbal message might be composed processes which are analogous in their structure to that which is occurring at the level of syntax, but are operating in the links between items, such as in the case of data or music, and characterization, an abstract characterization of a slightly property, such as object or situation. Again, by unification. And Haggard has argued that there could be different regions of the left inferior frontal gyrus would be involved in different types of communication. He argues that you have a gradient going from chronological communication to syntactic, thematic communication in different regions as you move more anteriorly in left inferior frontal gyrus. And implicit, implicit in this assumption is assumption about the neural underpinnings of tweaks to computational systems. And it's a very nice quote from the recent review paper of Lyons, where he argues that different cortical areas perform different computational functions, subtle or more prominent variation in subtle or more prominent variation in cell numbers, proportions, and pattern. Occasionally, these differences are reflected in distinct cycle architecture with well-defined bounds, but most often the differences are very subtle. So it could be that as you move to a neighboring region of the cortex, similar computations are going on, but with some, for instance, what the representations upon which they're operating could be different. This fits with the idea that you could have a similar sort of qualitative process coming on different types of representations, as Haggard has claimed in naming regions of cortex. So, I'm not going to discuss this, but I think abstraction too could be an important subprocess of abstraction, could be something like unification. Someone has an argument that the left inferior frontal gyrus is a pre-region for this type of tweak and the unification, which is mainly Haggard's rather than me. The second tweak that relates the left lateral region as a whole, rather than just left inferior frontal gyrus, is that there could be strong lateral inhibition between competitors. So I gave the example in dynamic of aphasia that as the more competition that there was from potential associations with the word, the more difficult it was for the patient. That clearly implies that the patients have difficulty in lateral inhibition processing and suppressing alternatives. And if one's going to, for instance, have an implementation of problem solving domains like the Tower of London that I talked about last time, where you have a very small problem space You have to make a series of moves in that bonus space in order to solve the problem. Then, if you don't have more than one alternative in each step, you're going to have a computational explosion. You'll be able to do what you need to at each step in your potential solution, select between alternatives. And this again is a lateral process. It appears to be a lateral dominant process. So the suggestion that I would make is that the lateral network has a strong degree of lateral division between alternatives. What about the right? Just take monitoring. I argue for two different processes dealing with the right lateral in the cortex. One was active monitoring, and the second was to do with goals of lateral transformations. This is a very nice ergonomic survey, Rizzo, three Italian psychologists. What they were concerned with, how you detect an error when you made an error. And they looked at about 500 detections of errors in either behavior like photocopy or more complex tasks like a new programming language. And what they showed was that you can detect an error in a whole series of different ways. For instance, progress being too slow, too expensive, too difficult, too ethical. So you give up on all of these different reasons. Or you might be, you may be using the resource that you know you're going to need later. So we may require assistance models, which is not available. Or it can be inappropriate if you have if you're doing a task which is only a subtask of a much more complex task. Could be any level of the hierarchy of tasks which where any of these could apply. And what they show is that these can be eventually very obvious, such as when the paper runs out in the photocopy, being very subtle, and you have to do quite a lot of complex inferences to realise that you've made a mistake. And the variety of possibilities suggests that you need to be monitoring on a whole parallel set of possibilities could be going on at the same time. It's not something just great, a single possible alternative. So what about, so that suggests a necessary attack of the mode of operation for monitoring. What about lateral transformations? I gave the example of the Hagen test last time, in which the task requires you to, but seems to require you to inhibit a speech output. But the patients dealt with this, or good patients, by thinking of the word that they had to produce before the inhibitory sentence they had to inhibit was actually presented. So they got round the difficulty by going orthogonally into another conceptual domain, then the time at which they did certain processes. So here again you have two different conceptual domains and you have to move from one to the other. The same thing applies, I'll argue with respect to insight. So take first a neuropsychological account. This comes from a study by Miller and Tippett in the late 1990s. They had match moving problems, such as the subject of initiative with the four squares, the squares of matches on the top. And has to then give instructions such as take two sticks away and leave you three squares. That can be done in one of four different ways. Have three problems of that sort, all of which involve moving external matches on that external sticks. In the final question that they have to deal with the problem is take four sticks away and leave one square. It's all the top symbols. Here you have to take out internal sticks. So you have to shift from the routine built up of the three into doing something different. And they found that the group that was impaired on this were right, shown by the right arrow. There were three columns on the left, the left hemisphere patients, three on the right hemisphere patients, with the right frontals being the left, most one of the three. So again, you want to have your right frontal effect. And Gold did a function imaging study where he found right ventrilateral pulmonary 47 to be critically involved in carrying out the tasks of his sort. I'm going to finish with the discussion of quite a long study, which was a, contrary to what I've been saying before, which was an imaging study, this structural imaging study about the amount of gray matter in particular regions. This was carried out by a student of ours from Trieste Mission, but the latest study, which is the more critical one, was carried out in Tehran. This involves the subject playing a game against the computer. The game is called the NIM or the subtraction game. It was invented about 100 years ago. It's a linear set of 15 boxes. And the player moves a counter, 1, 2, 3 boxes to the left, to the right. And the person wins the game, who gets the counter into the gold box, which is number 15. The typical way in which people start to tackle this, I should say that if you start and you play perfectly, you always win. But the person playing the computer plays perfectly. And so as soon as you make a single mistake, the computer wins. People start by working forward and seeing what they think to be good squares and bad squares. You can see the structure of this problem. If you get to position 11, then whatever the computer does, if it plays 1, 2 or 3, you can play 3, 2 or 1 and get 15 first. So 11 is a good square. If you get there, you can win if you play correctly. The same logic. Seven is a good square and three is a good square. So if you work forwards, you eventually might discover that 11 is a good square and then discover 7 is a good square. But there's an alternative procedure, which is to work backwards and forwards from the gold box, which is 3 plus 1, 3 the critical maximum you can use plus 1. And if you realize that this is arithmetic, then you can just apply that. And if you try to slightly change the rules by changing the number of moves you've made or something like that, then you can immediately switch to a new plan. What you see is that about 50% of student subjects playing this game many times against the computer show this sort of behavior. The bottom yellow line indicates whether the subject won or lost, and the naught or one. And you can see the sudden switch from losing every game to winning every game. Above that is the reaction time to make a move. And you can see that, well, it's not visible on the slide, the move before the inside of the flash, the subject is taking about 12 seconds to make an average move, to make a number of moves in each game. It's very good stuff. Immediately afterwards, they're making a move in 2 seconds. So you have very strong evidence, also in those movements, that the subjects who succeed in this task succeed in the inside of the flash, where they transform their going forward strategy using a simple arithmetical. They devise a simple arithmetical rule, a senior simple arithmetical rule, to enable them to carry out the appropriate rule in virtually no thought. In Tehran, She wrote, who was the lead author on this round, relayed medical students, hoping to see whether the sensitive brain matters in particular parts of the brain correlated with whether they were solvers or continue to work forward or work in the task. And again, the same regions that Gold had up before was found in this Redmond Area 47. And here again, you need to have a complete conceptual restructuring of what you're doing in order to satisfy the task. And you work and do it effectively. If you look at where our brain matter difference is shown on the left compared with gold, the gold is on the right, left and we're on the right. Again, very similar region in popular area. Completely different tasks, different analysis procedure. This was functional imaging, ours was brain matter. So I'm arguing that in addition to the possibility of unification being a process which is specific to one region of the prefrontal cortex, there could be a difference in the degree of the seriality, the degree of focus that's occurring between the two hemispheres, with more serial types of processing being left lateral, and more parallel sorts of processing being right lateral. With serial bit processing enabling winner-take all operations, such as in pump solving the names which are the tower under, or in, for instance, accurate, being accurate as opposed to being fast. One of the right lateral is involved in tasks which require parallel processing with many different alternatives and different types of conceptual domain. I'd just like to elaborate on these two different types of possible tweaks to a standard connection state network in order to deal with these different processes that seem to be going on in left and right in front of the port. These are people who did a lot of the work either in London or in Toronto or in Trieste or in Tehran. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim. My dear colleagues, are there any questions or comments? Forward with the mic.
It is a long question and it is difficult for me to speak English. That's why I will speak Russian and Russian will translate, okay? Sometimes I don't know. You know, if we speak about dynamic equation, I can. Can say about the main mechanism of the problems and compensatory mechanisms, how to overcome the problem. Okay. For example, we have a patient with dynamic hyperphagia who cannot learn his utterances. How he can compensate this problem? If somebody will ask the question, it will be easier to answer. Usually, the patients with dynamic hyperphagia have no problems in answering. But if he has to say in our experiment, he can use sensomotor stereotypes which he has as the result of his experience before. Это понятно. Is it clear this?
So far.
Yeah. And in this case, if the answer could be chosen from the little possibilities, not so many possibilities, yeah, it will be easier to choose the answer. If the answer, the patient has to choose the answer from many possibilities, it will be more difficult for him. But it is not the main, it is the explanation of problems with compensation. It is not the explanation of his primary defect. What do you think about it?
Well, I was arguing it's one of the potential two major problems, the other being possible problems of unification. But if you think it's not the major, if you think it's a compensation problem, maybe you should say what you think the problem really is. This type of model. One thing I was arguing was that there needs to be unification process not just at the grammatical level, but also at the level of the conceptual framework in which the patient has to produce. Now, what you said seemed to be could be represented as a structure like the Jackendorf structure here, only possibly more complex still because it would relate to the representation of more than one sentence.
It could be.
Which would fit with the unification type of explanation rather than with the lateral inhibition. But I still don't see how you know that the lateral inhibition problem is purely compensatory and not a key element of it.
Prove this. disability for me. I have two patients with achromatism. One of them had more motor problems, and the other had many, not so many motor problems. They do the test for construction of sentences on the same level. It was difficult for them to construct correct sentence. And we also checked their understanding of reverse active passive sentences. And they have the problems on the same level. And we give them test on finding the mistakes in the text. How to name this test? The verification of grammar, grammaticality judgment. If we give grammaticality judgment test, we will see different results. The patients is less motor problems. Has less mistakes in grammaticality judgment. He can say, it is wrong. I don't know why, but I know that this sentence is wrong. And the patient with more severe motor problem, she can decide which one is correct, which one is not. I think it is the proof of the possibility to use motor schemes which are in our experience. Sorry for my...
Now, I agree with you that they not construct the pre-verbal message appropriately, which requires construction of a representation of the semantics of the situation. But I don't see it's entirely conceivable to me that the construction of such a model requires lateral communication processes, so that one could be a component of the other, so to speak. And incidentally, the patients that we described had very, as I just described, the two patients. One had very mild agrammatism, but the other had no agrammatism at all.
But they have the same level of agrammatism. And we saw it in production of sentences, and also in understanding of sentences. The level of agrammatism was the same.
You're talking about my patients.
No, I'm talking about
this. Okay, sorry. Yes.
Colleagues, are there more questions or comments? Or we can make them privately, as after the previous lecture. If nobody wants to ask questions, then we can just thank the team for the second lecture.
Yeah, I trained as a linguist, but actually
But then I agree from one of the playboy witches. Because you were supposed to know that, but you didn't manage to have it.